Sahanavavatu, Sahanavunaktu, Sahavilyam karavavahai, Tejasvinavadhitamastu mavidvishavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Om Bhadram Karune Vishniyama Deva. Bhadram Pashre Makshabhirya Jatra. Stirairangaihi Sushtu Vagum Sastanubihi. Vyashema-deva-hitayadayuhu Swastina-indro-vritta-shravah Swastina-pusha-vishva-vedah Swastina-starksho-harishta-nemihi Swastino-brahaspatir-dadatu Om Shanti Shanti Shanti
Om Brahma Devanam
Om Brahma Devanam
Prathamasambhabhuva Vishvasya Karta
Vishvasya Karta
Upanasya Gupta
Upanasya Gupta
Sabrahma Vidyam
Sabrahma Vidyam
Sarva Vidya Pratishtham
Sarva Vidya Pratishtham
Atharvaya
Atharvaya
Jyeshtha Putraya Praha
Jyeshtha Putraya Praha
So we saw last time, just a little recap. Why? In lieu of a quiz, it's a recap. Because a quiz after 1 month is painful, correct?
Yes.
To me, not to you.
Yeah.
So therefore, just a recap. We have been seeing that one particular point Adi Shankara has taken an important point, and what is that? That there is, you know, there is no mix up of
knowledge and karma.
So, to put it elegantly in Sanskrit, jnana karma samuchaya Vada Khandanam. Khand to deride. Khandanam. Khand plus lut. Yeah. Lut becomes?
Ana.
Very good. Yes. Excellent. By the sutra, you go ranaka. Wonderful. You know? So, lut becomes ana. So, khand plus ana khandanam. Correct? And so the derision and the critique or the criticism of this vada, what is this vada means what? Of a contention. And what is this contention? What does this contention say? What does it contain? A little bit of moksha, a little bit of karma. Why can't I have it all? Why can't I have the karma and have the jnanam also? This is actually an ancient vada. We think it's like a western, modern, contemporary thing of, you know, how is it expressed in SMS language? FOMO. What is FOMO? I told you once. F-O-M-O. Kim tat? Fear of missing out. What it is. This is what it is. We think it's a contemporary situation. We think it's a contemporary cultural, you know, problem that people are not able to commit to anything because they're afraid of missing out on something else. Like if you go trekking, you're missing out on rapid river rafting, you know. And if you go rapid river rafting, then you're missing out on this You know that spider game? That, what is that? That spider.
Huh?
Like bungee cord jumping. Yeah. You see all that? Like a spider, you know, you are hanging out. Same from this Upanishad, just like the Urna Nabhi goes up and down. You are just going up and down without the knowledge of what that means. And so this fear of missing out is a huge thing. And we think it is all because we are living in Bhoga Bhumi. It is Bhoga Bhumi. The land of enchanted consumption. The land of enchantment translated into the land of conspicuous consumption. At least if you lived in, forget Yoga Bhumi, at least if you lived in Karma Bhumi, some, you know, possibility is there for Karma Yoga. And after that, from there to get jnana, some preparation, some possibility is there. But if you live in Bhoga Bhumi, all you are always afraid of, if you pursue something, something else is happening that I am missing out on. Correct? That is why this is a culture, we think. The contemporary culture is the one of least commitment. It's all this flaky thing. Everything, all pursuits are flaked off. I mean, there is no perseverance. There is no committed pursuit. There is no nishtha. Nishtha means the committed pursuit is not there. Nitaram sthiti is not there. Because as soon as that commitment comes, that fear of commitment is fear of missing out something else. And this is sheer adhyasa, ajnanam actually. And that ajnanam produces the adhyasa, the subjective perception is called adhyasa. It produces the subjective perception that all pursuits are one and the same. And this is what Adi Shankara is saying, you know, I beg to differ. In fact, he doesn't beg, he just differs. He differs as a begging person, because that's why he says, Bhaikshacharyam Charantaha, we saw that quote. He differs. And why does he differ? He says basically that this, if all pursuits are one and the same, meaning they have that same weightage, or that sameness, identical. They are identical in terms of, if you do one, you cannot do the other. They are identical in terms of effort needed, in terms of what is at the end of that. They are identical. If all pursuits are identical like that, then you can pursue anything. Correct? You can pursue anything at all and not be worried. Because one is same as the other. No problem. But this is where the rub is, because all pursuits are not identical. Like George Orwell said in a different context, where in Animal Farm, George Orwell said, all animals are equal, but some animals are more equal than others. So to here, all pursuits are equal. Wait. There is one pursuit, however, that is really the only pursuit, which when not understood, you know, whose seriousness, when it's not understood, just sort of multiplies into, like an amoeba, multiplies into various pursuits. Various pursuits are a subterfuge to this one and only pursuit, which is called jnanam. What kind of jnanam? Atma jnanam, atma prajna, the knowledge of oneself, that one being everything. And so this has to be understood to overcome this FOMO problem, fear of missing out. Because really speaking, if you are in this room right now, you're not missing out on anything. Why? Because it's too early for anything else in Eugene to be taking place. So that's why we kept the class at this time. So there is no FOMO problem. So this is what the whole thing is. It's not, you know, you're not missing out on anything. Why? Seriously speaking, you're not missing out on anything because in this pursuit is included the fruit of all other pursuits. So actually this pursuit is being the pursuit of yourself really. And are you there or not?
Yes.
Yes. So what are you pursuing if you're already there? What are you pursuing?
Huh? Housekeeping.
Yeah, so you're really, that is karma. At the level of jnanam, you're not pursuing anything. At the level of karma, some internal landscape pruning and ragadvesha cutting and, grafting and, blowing away the various leaves that have accumulated. Those are all housekeeping at the level of karma. But at the level of jnanam, this pursuit is an as-though pursuit. It's a non-pursuit really. Because like a dog chasing its own tail, you're pursuing yourself. Except you're not running around in circles. You're very much here and you're pursuing yourself. And that self is siddha vastu, means it's an established fact. You are already there. It's not sadhya vastu, it's not something I have to accomplish myself. No. I have to accomplish my nature. No. I have to embellish my nature. No. I have to improve my nature. Not at all. Because you are that which cannot be improved upon, which cannot be accomplished, which is not something to be ascertained. It's already the whole, it is already complete, it is already, you are already free. So what is it that you are pursuing? You cannot even say I am pursuing moksha, freedom, because you are already free. Siddha vastu, vishaya. This is an accomplished fact, so what is it that you are pursuing? Nothing, correct? Mm-hmm. So the pursuit is an as though pursuit. To understand the nature of that which already is and which already is myself. And to understand that nature, what I am doing is more of a removal. So the pursuit really translates, when you look deeply, into a removal of that which covers the truth of myself. That ajnanam, the covering of ajnanam, is removed so that the sun of knowledge, which is already shining, can be discovered as myself. So this is a very different pursuit, please understand. Because in every other pursuit, you are going after something to be gained. This is all, other pursuits are based on yoga kshema. What is yoga kshema? A dish to be had along with every meal. Yes? No. That doesn't sound right. Okay. What is yoga kshema? What is yoga? Yeah, apraptasya praptam. You better say it now. Apraptasya praptam. Yeah, apraptasya praptihi.
Apraptasya praptihi.
Yogaha.
Yogaha.
Praptasya rakshana.
Praptasya rakshana.
Kshema.
Kshema.
Praptasya rakshana. Kshemaha. Okay? Apraptasya praptihi. The gain of that which is not yet gained is what is called yoga. The protection of that, the guarding of that which is already gained is called kshema. Now the very important question that is raised in the previous discussion, which we are still recapping, is whether the pursuit of atma-jnanam, the self-knowledge, or whether the pursuit of the self, or whether the pursuit of moksha, is it the same as all other yoga kshema pursuit? No. Because what is there that is not gained? Nothing. The self is a gained gain. It's already gained. It is self-existent. It is self-revealing. It is an accomplished fact. Because the self is self-existent, all other pursuits are there, including the pursuit of the self. You cannot pursue a non-existent self. How would you do that, you know? So, and you cannot pursue an existent self. That is also a very interesting paradox. Neither can you pursue a non-existent self, nor can you pursue an existent self. Yes, Mat? Because it is existent. Existent tattvat. You know, you cannot pursue that. So, this is a very interesting paradox. So then yoga does not apply. And what about kshema? Guarding that which is already, you know, is. So somebody is coming to take away the self from me. So I have to growl each time anybody approaches like a territorial dog. You just go near the dog or whatever you think, it thinks that it belongs. To you know, it belongs something, you know, something belongs to it, it thinks. You go near whatever it thinks that it is its, what will it do? First a gargling sound will come. Yeah. And then a low warning growl. Then it starts to bark. And if you still don't listen, then it will bite. So this is what is called praptasya rakshanam. It's easy to understand it when it's exemplified with the help of a dog. But everyone does it all the time. Everybody engages in, you know, in a warning growl once in a while. Keep out, this is mine. You know, we do it in much more subtle ways, that's all. We put a sign, keep out, keep out. We put a sign, what is that sign? Trespassers will be prosecuted. And we also control who rings the bell. We say, solicitors not allowed. You know, the bell is outside, anybody can come and ring. No. Anybody who is asking for anything, don't ring the bell. We do that. Correct? And then we put a fence to delineate what is ours from what is theirs. Then you put a name plate on what is yours. You put a name on it. So like this we also engage in dogged behavior of delineating what is one's own. Correct? And so here, the rest of the things to be gained in time. And of course if something is gained in time, it's lost in time. So things that are gained and lost in time come under yoga kshema pursuits. But the knowledge of the self is completely different. We saw this all earlier. Completely different. It has nothing to do with that. So when you are pursuing Atma Jnana, karma cannot interfere because in fact karma has no role. Like oil and water, the two do not mix. Even in a salad dressing, this is the note on which the last class was ended. They do not mix. And so there is no, you know, there cannot be any propensity for karma to enter even slightly in the pursuit of Atma Jnanam, which is why this Upanishad heavily emphasizes monasticism. You know, monasticism exemplified not by the color of the clothes, but by the coloration of one's disposition. And what is this disposition? The disposition that is highly developed, in which vairagya, or the giving up of everything that doesn't matter, because every pursuit is really a non-pursuit. Because every pursuit we saw last time, every pursuit, if I pursue what I get, is out of breath. That's all. Because if you gain something that is time bound, then what happens? It goes away. It is time bound. It is finite. Then you have to gain something else that is also equally finite. So you are constantly out of breath. And so therefore, that is a non, you know, dead-end pursuit. Every pursuit is a dead-end pursuit, leaving you deadened and jaded. Because this is why, this is why Adi Shankara says, that there is one pursuit which is unlike every other pursuit. And that pursuit alone fulfills, because the truth of you is revealed as the nature of the one who pursues all these various things. And that nature being totally complete, there is no need to pursue anything. Yeah, there is no need to pursue anything. If it happens, it happens. Otherwise, let it go, let it go, let it go. The more you say let it go, the more there is inner growth. And so for the person who keeps saying let it go, this Upanishad speaks. For the person who holds on to things that are always going, the Upanishad will speak in a foreign tongue. Already Sanskrit is a foreign tongue. Yeah, Sanskrit, by now you are a little bit familiar, but this is even more foreign than Sanskrit. Upanishad will start to speak in tongues which are, you know, which cannot be untied, which cannot be understood, because the preparation in the form of the inner disposition of a sannyasi is not there, which is what Adi Shankara points out. Is that is why this Upanishad heavily talks about vairagya, you know, keeping aside, suspending, if not being able to let go of those pursuits that have nothing to do with understanding the timeless as oneself. So having said that, he quietly inserts a big bombshell. What is that? The reason for him saying that. Why does he prefer Vidya over Karma? You know, why? And he quietly says, and we'll read this, Vidya Karma,
Vidya Karma,
Virodhacha,
Virodhacha.
Yeah. Cha means it's an afterthought. And besides, by the way, no, here it's a very big thing. Vidya Karma Virodhat. Virodhat, which case?
Ablative,
fifth case. Means here it's showing a cause. Mm. And what is the cause here? The cause is why this pursuit is important and why this Atma Vidya is unlike any other pursuit and why Karma has no role here. That is what is being explained through the fifth case here, Vidya Karma Virodhat. Virodhat means on account of the contradictory nature of Vidya, Atmajnanam here, and Karma. So action and knowledge are contradictory in nature. So when you say Avidya, you know, this is a very long discussion. When you say Avidya, there is a negative particle, which is A, coming in front of Vidya, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So when you say Avidya, it's a negation of the word Vidya. But in Sanskrit, we have a sophisticated kind of a negation. It's a kind of a four different ways the negative particle, nanj, is used. So one is abhave. Abhave means it is not there. You know, like a square circle. Is it there? No. So then you would say what? A square circle. You put a and you negate square circle. You know, atyanta abhava. It's a possibility of it being is not there. That is one sense of the negative particle being used. But more commonly, it is alparthe. So first is abhavarthe, means it is not there, simply it is non-existent. And then second one is what? Alparthe. Alpa means a small amount is there. And this is in colloquial language, we find this a lot. And I don't know how, but even people living in Eugene, sometimes I have heard them lament. Eugene Nagarya, Avrishtihi. What? In the city of Eugene, in the town of Eugene, there is no rain. People lament. I don't know how, but it is. People do that. So when they say no rain and you look out and it is raining and you are confused, what does that mean?
Not
enough rain. Alavanam bhojanam. Bhojanam means what? That everyone should know. Bhojanam from bhuj to consume.
Yes.
Yeah. That's how bhokta comes. So what is bhojanam? That which is to be consumed. that which is an object of consumption, here food. Alavanam means not enough salt. It's not that there is no salt. But then frequently when, you know, the food is served, you take a few bites, what? There is no salt in this food. There is salt, but it's not enough. So the negative particle is used in the sense of not enough. Correct? Then there is, this is called abhavarthe. In the sense, alparthe in the sense of not enough. In the sense of little bit is there. Avrishtihi, alavanam, etc. Then there is one more sense in which the negative particle is used, and that is called anyarthe. Anyarthe means other than what is being discussed. And a classic example is abrahmanam anaya. Bring who? Abrahmana. Not a brahmana. Means bring anyone except a brahmana, please. You know? Means other than. You see, this is not the same as avrishtihi, less than. This is not the same as non-existent. This is what? Other than. This is the third meaning. And finally, the fourth meaning, virodharthe, negative particle, nanj, is used in the sense of opposition, completely opposite. So when you say ajnanam, this is very important. So the negative particle nanj has come, a has come, that has negated jnana. But which sense of negation is it?
No.
That means jnanam is non-existent. First sense if we take, what happens? Then what are we doing here early in the morning? If there is no jnanam, jnanam is absolutely, you know, atyantika abhava is there of jnanam, is not at all there. Then what are we doing here pursuing something that is non-existent? So that cannot be, correct? Alparthe means, ajnanam means lack of knowledge, correct? Knowledge is there but lack of knowledge. This is what people often, you know, translate ajnanam as lack of knowledge. Then anyarthe, something other than knowledge, no. And finally what? Virodharthe. Ajnanam is opposed to jnanam. This is the meaning, this is the sense in which the word has to be understood. Otherwise we run into some very interesting problems. If you take it in terms of a simple negation, jnanam not there, you know, then what will happen? So before jnanam, what was there? Ajnanam. Then jnanam replaces ajnanam. Correct? And then it is further replaced, because then it can also go away, it can be further replaced by ajnanam. Because if you say there was something before jnanam and that was ajnanam, when you say that, you are running into murky territory in terms of analysis. Very difficult to extricate oneself from. And if you say lack of knowledge, if you use it in the second instance of alparthe, lack of knowledge, you know, who is going to decide how much lack and what is this going to fill, and then how to promise that the lack will not come again? That which is subject to lack is always subject to lack. But here we are talking of the knowledge that fills up everything. Sarvam purayati iti purusha. That atma which is described as purusha, that which fills up everything, that which is complete, purnaha. So really speaking, that lack does not apply here. Anyarthe, there is nothing other than knowledge. Because that self that we seek to discover happens to be in the form of all knowledge. Satyam jnanam anantam. That knowledge which is limitless, which is non-negatable, which stands the same in all periods of time, which is not time bound. That is what we are talking about, which is in the form of jnanam. Everything is in the form of jnanam. You look at an object, for even, you know, for example, this flower, a nice flower. So you say, I see petals. What is, when you say, I see flower, what are you seeing really? Flower, jnanam is what is evident. When you say, okay, I don't see flower, I see petals, petal jnanam, because how it is arranged, in what way it has bloomed, and how the leaves match the flower, how the brush of Ishvara has, he's used three shades here, four actually if you count the middle. So, the brush of Ishvara has nicely tinted the various petals. What you see in the brush of Ishvara is jnana, the knowledge of flower. When you say, I know flower, you are transcending the name and form, and you say, I know what this flower is. When you say flower is, you say, I know flower, that's what it is. Flower is nothing but flower knowledge is. So everywhere there is knowledge, knowledge, knowledge. So where is the place for ajnana? Where is the place for ajnana? There is no place for ajnana. Oh, so there is no ajnana? Technically speaking, there is no ajnana. Oh, then why am I sitting here? Can I get up and go? Yes, you can, to put it in the words of Obama. But but really speaking, you may not want to do that right now. Why? Because we are talking of something which as though projects as ajnana. In and through that which is all jnanam, there is the presence of as though ajnana. That as though ajnanam, which is opposed to jnanam, is what is being spirited away here through the study of this Upanishad, as he is going to say later. So what is this as though ajnanam? The as though ajnanam is the covering as it were. The katma cannot be covered, neither can jnanam be covered. So the as though ajnanam is the as though covering. Of what? Of that same jnana shakti of Ishvara, manifested at the jivik level. Yeah. Jivik, like Vedic. Mayik, exactly. So that which is all knowledge for Ishvara. So you have, jiva, then on the other side of the continuum you have Ishvara. Correct? In between you have Maya. And Maya, when she looks at Ishvara and talks to Ishvara, all knowledge, all smiles, all beaming, all power, all shakti, everything wonderful. And when Jiva looks at Maya, I think I need glasses. Can't see very clearly what, who, where, which inspires the jiva to compose sad songs. Darshan kab doge? When will you give darshan? Why are you so elusive? Don't play hide and seek with me. So the maya is the screen, the smoke screen literally. Because at the level of the jiva, it translates into avidya. Avidya upadhi avachinnaha jivaha. Avachinnaha means what? From chid, to cover, to constrict, completely. Avachinnaha means completely constricted, completely delimited by what? Avidya in the form of the upadhi, the one whose upadhi itself is avidya. Ayayyo. What to do now? I thought my upadhi was this, 5 feet so many inches tall, and this many, this much weight, this much height, this is my occupation. These are all examples of upadhi, yes. But those are examples of specific upadhi. But everyone has two kinds of upadhi. One is the specific upadhi in terms of, when you stand in front of the mirror, you get the statistics of the specific upadhi. Any jiva, from the worm to the person, or to the hippo, when it stands in front of the mirror, it gets the specificities of the upadhi come alive, but then everyone has a general upadhi as long as one is incarnated. What is this general upadhi? Avidya. Avidya upadhi avachinnaha jivaha. And then Ishvara has also a specific upadhi depending on how you invoke Ishvara. You say Vishnu and then you see Shankha Chakra and you see all kinds of things and you know you see Vishnu, you see Vishnu, you hear the tales of Vishnu saving Gajendra and you see all kinds of things, correct? That is one particular upadhi, you know, and then you say Shiva, Shivaratri just went by and then you see the smeared with holy ash everywhere and then you see, you know, Kriti Vasam and what is this, the wearing animal skin and deer skin, all these things, tiger skin, all these things you see. This is the specific upadhi of Ishvara invoked as Ishta Devata. Then there is a general upadhi of Ishvara. The Ishvarik upadhi is what? All knowledge. Sarvajnaha Sarvavit. Sarvajnaha Sarvavit. So there is a general upadhi of Ishvara and then there is the specific upadhi from the standpoint of the way in which we invoke from the avatara. So all knowledge is whose upadhi is called Ishvara. Small knowledge is whose upadhi. Small knowledge means knowledge of small things once in a while, mostly forgotten. This is what is Jiva's lot. And so therefore, when the Mahavakya comes and tells, and what does the Mahavakya tells? You are Ishvara. Through Lakshya, through an indicatory sentence, what do we mean by that? We mean that we transcend. What do we transcend? We transcend Maya. Maya metam tarantite. You transcend Maya. You transcend the upadhi. At the level of upadhi, there can be no equation. So therefore, we have to use lakshya, the indirect understanding of tattvamasi, the word tattvamasi. We cannot do vachyartha. We cannot see the direct meaning of the words. The immediate meaning of the words, you are Ishvara, doesn't yield any knowledge. Except some depression. Oh, I don't think this is true. This can never be true. It in fact makes one sad. Don't give me all this. Don't call me Ishvara. Ishvara does not have back pain. You know, that is what you feel like saying. But this is not operating at the level of upadhi. You transcend the upadhi to see the truth. Just like when, you know, to use Pujya Swamiji's example, when you say touch wood, you know, whenever you use the expression touch wood, you don't have to go to the lumber yard or you don't have to go to a forest and hug a tree, correct? You can say touch wood and touch a table. You're not looking at the table, you have transcended the upadhi which is the table and you have contacted the wood. You can say touch wood, this time I'm touching the chair handle. And as Pujya Swamiji says, if nothing is available, people say touch wood. No comments on that. No need to comment on that. So touch wood is something, that is the example at which this Mahavakya works to show that the upadhi is something that is time bound. Is something that is an as though enjoys an as though existence that can neither be affirmed nor denied. This is the nice thing about Maya. That is the difficult thing about Maya. Sat asat bhyam anirvachaniya maya. Means you cannot categorically dismiss maya and say maya does not exist. Then what happens? You know, it's like driving on an Indian road and saying potholes are all mithya. Then after subjecting yourself to mithya potholes, then you have to look for the number of a mithya chiropractor, correct?
Yeah.
So you cannot dismiss maya, and yet you cannot affirm maya and say that that is the fire that really exists. Cannot say. Like you cannot say flower ultimately is, no? Flower is really, and then when you look into the more into the flower, flower is not, this is not flower, this is flower, no, this is not flower, this is a leaf. Is this flower? No, that's a petal. What is this? Stamen. That's not a flower. This is stem. That's not a flower. Then if you were, you know, then if you were a 3-year-old, because this is what happens when you give a flower to the 3-year-old. The 3-year-old is a mechanic at heart, takes everything apart. So the 3-year-old will start to remove every non-flower aspect. Then what is left? Zero. Nothing is left. What is left is the observer of the flower. That is what is left, not zero. So therefore, you cannot affirm the flower, but you cannot say there is no, you know, karatale pushpam nasti, you cannot say. You cannot say there is no flower in my hand because it is, you know, drishtatvat, because you see it. So this is maya, that is why it, you know, it's a curved ball. Very, very interesting. And so this kind of knowledge that is as though covered by this as though force, kalpita shakti, it's not a parallel reality to Ishvara. Maya is not a parallel reality. Maya is not other than Ishvara. Maya is not something, you know, apart from Ishvara. And Maya is not something born of Ishvara either, because if it's born of Ishvara, it should be existence. It becomes a parallel reality. No. Maya is an as though power of Ishvara that makes the one into many, which makes it difficult to ascertain the truth of one's own nature. Even though one is already Brahman, one still has to pursue Brahman, which is the reason why you should not get up and go right now, a long answer. You know, but there is a way of crossing, and this crossing will not come as long as you are interested in other pursuits that are karma based. As long as you are interested in karma based pursuits, what's going to happen? Nothing. Because karma and jnanam, see, because jnanam is, I told you, it's effortless last time. So if it is effortless, then there is nothing to do. No, but I have to come here and I have to sit and listen to you. Yes. Listening takes place. You don't know how hard it is to wake up in the morning. I wish I could say waking up takes place. With the help of alarm, waking up does take place. Actually, what wakes you up? This is small, interesting, what is that? Shastric tidbit. Yeah. What is that? What wakes you up is not the alarm. Really? What wakes you up is prarabdha, that is the alarm. Alarming thought, but that's what it is. Prarabdha puts you to sleep, prarabdha wakes you up. But what about if you are an insomniac? Then also it is prarabdha alone. Good sleep is good prarabdha. Yes. And prarabdha decides, okay, today you have to do all kinds of things. So wake up. So suddenly you wake up. Otherwise there is the mysterious. How do you wake up? When you see that prarabdha, your own karma wakes you up. The karma that is to be exhausted in this lifetime wakes you up feeling exhausted. That is what it is. So then vidya and karma have no connection to each other. Because vidya, karma reproduces ajnanam. What is the reproduction of ajnanam? I told you, ajnanam has a genealogy, correct? You know, if you go to genealogy.com, ancestry.com and type in Ajnanam, you know what will come? What should come? Yeah. What should come out is the following. First, there is non-knowing of my own nature, Ajnanam. Atma Ajnanam. And then what? What is the brood? What is the child of Ajnanam? Because of Ajnanam, what happens?
Desire.
Kama. And then Kama has a child?
Karma.
Karma. Because Kama is not going to allow you to sit quietly. As soon as the desire arises, you have to do something to make it fulfilled, correct? Because it's other than you. It's something apraptasya praptihi. You have to go and gain it. And then what happens? Karma has twins, correct? What are they? Papa and Punya. So, karma phala. And then Papa and Punya also have children called Janma after Janma after Janma after Janma after Janma. Then you get into this incessant regression. That's what it is. So this is the shrinkhala, the genealogy of avidya. So ajnanam reproduces itself infinitely. Then, and to put it in Sanskrit, it is called avidya kama karma shrinkhala. The main scenes of avidya are accounted for. They don't talk about the, if you say kama and karma, then the others are understood. Avidya kama karma shrinkhala. So that is the parampara of avidya. Avidya has its own lineage. And avidya wants you to be very loyal to its lineage. So as soon as anybody gets slightly interested in the knowledge, then avidya comes out and says, no, no, no. Why you are going and sitting early in the morning? Have you lost, taken leave of your senses? Have you lost your mind? There is so many important things to do, starting with cleaning the house, doing 5 weeks of laundry and doing all kinds of things, catch up, catch up, catch up. And people feel good about saying, I'm catching up. But it's always in present continuous. Nobody says, I have caught up. This is one thing always I find in present continuous. And a slight aside, another thing that's also in present continuous is the term recovering Catholic. Nobody says I'm a recovered Catholic. Always recovering. Always catching up. Always catching up. So by the time you have caught up, there is more to catch up. So therefore, you know, you are in a catch-up of karma. That's all it is. That is what this catch-up game is. The catch-up game is a spoof. You can't catch up. This is samsara. The definition of samsara, that which you cannot get caught up on, that is samsara. Same thing, you look in the news in the morning, I am caught up on the new news. Somebody else dies and makes news. Somebody else is born and makes news. Somebody else gets sick and makes news. And then? Somebody else gets old and makes new someone's birthday. Why am I using these examples? Janma, mrityu, jara, vyadhi. Somebody dies, somebody is born. So the news is constantly being, you know, updated. That's why you have to keep pressing the refresh button on your browser. This is what it is. You cannot catch up even on the news. Cannot catch up. This is samsara. Therefore, the safest thing to do is to understand the nature of the catcher upper, which doesn't need to be caught upon, that which doesn't need to be updated, which doesn't need to be refreshed, because it is ever fresh, sanatanaha, puranaha, that which is ancient and ever new. This is what I have to know. So what role has karma in knowledge? No role at all. So virodha, the relationship between avidya and karma is one of opposition. And he is going to say later that wherever there is light, there cannot be darkness. So therefore, wherever there is jnanam, ajnanam is spirited away. There is no place for this ajnanam. So the role of karma this karma has at best an ancillary role in terms of a supportive role in terms of preparing the person to own up, to face and assimilate the truth of these teachings. So it has a supportive role, a preparatory role. You can say, I need karma to have more viveka, more vairagya, more shama, dama, uparati, titiksha, shraddha. What's the last one? Samadhanam, mumukshutvam. All these things I need to gain. These are the preparations, because without preparation, then the knowledge will speak in tongues that cannot be understood. So karma cannot be dismissed, but karma cannot be affirmed as the means for knowledge. No, the means for knowledge is shravanam alone. So even though it's karma that made you drive here, it's karma that made you sit down, that's where the role of karma ends. Because listening takes place. You don't employ will while listening. There is no will in knowledge. Like if I were to say, look at this wonderful apple. First you will give me the benefit of doubt and say, okay, she picked up the wrong thing by mistake. She's showing the flower. But you know, saying apple. And then what? Then I'll say, look at this wonderful orange. And then I will say, finally we have a great looking flower. Then you say, okay, you know, up till now she was all right. Something happened after she went to India and came back. You know, you say that. Because this is, you know, your knowledge that this is flower is unshakable. And it is effortless. It cannot be negated. And so therefore, so too, Atmajnanam, the knowledge of I, is unshakable and cannot be negated. In fact, flower knowledge is nothing but I, because that I is told to be the truth of everything. Flower knowledge, flower resolves into flower knowledge resolves into the knower, which is I, and the knower resolves into that, which is out of which, that jnanam out of which knower and known are produced as time-bound entities in relational and time-bound entities. The truth of which is that knowledge which is past the knower and past the known, which is beyond the knower and the known, which does not morph into the knower and the known, and even if it morphs, it is a as though morphing. That same cognition. So the cognizer and the cognized are that one and same endless consciousness which manifests as the cognizer, which also manifests as the cognized, at the same time yugapat, because it is limitless. That sentience alone is being revealed here, and for which karma has no role. Karma has to be, you know, divested of any kind of credit or status or job and sent home to read further. Vidya karma virodhat cha. Nahi.
Nahi.
Brahmatma.
Brahmatma.
Ekatva.
Ekatva.
Darshanena saha.
Darshanena saha.
Karma.
Karma.
Swapnepi.
Swapnepi.
Sampadaitum.
Sampadaitum.
Shakyam.
Shakyam.
He yasmat. You know, yasmat means because, you know, hetu, here. He means many things. He means, you know, he means indeed, Hawaii. He also means because. But here, vidya karma virodhat, he has given a cause there. Hetu has been given. Because fifth case is used in the sense of hetu. And then, so therefore, the he is because. And he's giving the reason. Because he made a blanket statement. Because vidya and karma are opposed to each other, and he is giving why. He is giving the reason why here. He says, not because, not in even one's dream. Brahmatma aikyatva darshanam. So, you know, the oneness of Brahman and Atma cannot be established by karma. Even in your dreams. So dream on, he says. if you want to deploy karma as a means of gaining knowledge seriously, with any kind of seriousness, please keep on dreaming. And he goes as far as to say, even in dreams, because certain impossible things you cannot even dream of. You can only dream what you know, correct?
Yeah.
You cannot dream of something unknown. And so here, this is so outlandish. It is so out of the running. The fact, the wrong assumption that karma and jnanam can go side by side at the same time and together produce this baby called knowledge. No, not possible. Karma and jnanam, first of all, don't get along. They will not even date. Their horoscopes will not match. They will not get married and not have a child called Atma Jnanam. Not possible, he says. They just don't get along. Virodhatcha. So even in your dream, swapne api sampadayitum, even in dream to manufacture such a situation. And what is the situation? Karma saha sahita, along with the karma. The coexistence of jnanam and karma is not possible even in dream. And you know, because and the coexistence of jnanam and karma for what? For the sake of gaining this knowledge. Ekatva darshanam. And what is this ekatva darshanam? The seeing of oneness between Brahman and Atma. Seeing Atma as Brahman. And seeing that Brahman cannot be anything other than Atma. And what is this Brahman? Satyam Jnanam Anantam. We have seen this already in a different context. That which is the truth of everything, the context and the content of all existence, which happens to be unlimited by time, limitless, which is outside the time-space matrix, which exists by itself, self-standing, and this Sat, this existence which is non-negatable and self-standing and limitless, happens to be in the form of consciousness, sentience, jnanam, that is above and beyond the morphing of the knower and known. That out of which, that which sustains the knower and the known without being either the known or the knower. And then, you know, that which is anantam, that which is limitless. Limitless in terms of time, space and object. So this is what I have to know this I, which parades as a sad individual, playing sad songs on the tiny violin, you know. Then this individual has to be understood, has to know himself or herself as that which is the cause of the universe. As that Brahman, Brahman here is Ishvara. As that which is the cause of the universe, I have to understand. And what role does karma have to play? Even in dream, karma cannot do this. Because, I'll tell you why. Because if Brahman and Atma were different, karma cannot unite the two, correct? Mm-hmm. Even supposing a treaty was signed between Brahman and Atma, the two shall be regarded as one for the sake of certain time, until eternity. Sometimes they give, you know, in India they give lease of land for 99 years, you know, for ashrams and all. They say, okay, I don't want to give it, but I want to, you know, because then there is taxes and legal problems. So they say, leased for 1 rupee. It's a very interesting way of putting it. So 1 rupee per month or 1 rupee per year for 99 years. So you cannot say Brahman and Atma enter into this contractual lease where the two are one for 99 years. Okay, 99 is finite, correct? after 99 what? Separation. Viyogante samyogaha. So the union is only until separation. And what is the factor of separation? Time. Time and karma go together, because what is produced in time dies in time, ends in time. So if it is, if this union between Brahman and Atma were to be forged by karma, that means what? It was not united in the first place. two separate things were there, and that is what, that is, goes against the Shastra, correct? Yeah, that goes against the Shruti Pramana, to say that Brahman and Atma are different and have to be brought together. This Yojanam has to take place by karma. I have to forcibly bring them together because they are two different entities. Then that goes against the Shastra. And if they are two different entities, we have an interesting circumstance, situation called Anirmoksha Prasanga. What is Anirmoksha Prasanga? Where moksha is not possible. Why is moksha not possible? Because as soon as I unite, I am going to separate. That's what it is. Because everything is time bound. The union is a product of time. So if the union is a product of time, the separation is just a matter of time. Naturally. So therefore what? So therefore this karma, even in dream, cannot have any role in trying to quote unquote unite Brahman with Atma, because that uniting has already taken place. It's a pre-existent fact. And karma, as we have seen, has no place in knowledge, in the quote-unquote production of knowledge, because knowledge is not produced, it is just uncovered. Oh, but then karma can uncover, karma cannot uncover. Why? Because karma only produces more covering, we have seen that. Karma cannot uncover, because the uncovering happens in Shravanam. Shravanam is... again, not an action. Listening is not an action. Listening happens. There is no will, because karma means there should be will. There is no will in action. There is no will at all. I mean, in listening. If there was will in listening, then you can selectively choose what to hear. But that's not the case. You hear heavy metal music, even though you don't want to hear it, you hear it. Especially if you have a teenager at home, you are forced to hear it. And you hear things being said about you, even though you don't want to hear. You are just passing through a room and you hear something and you hear your name spoken. Naturally, the footsteps become a little less fast. You don't mean to overhear, but you overhear. That is what is called overhearing. Over what? Over your own will, you hear. That is what is called overhearing. There is no will based. You hear what is there to hear. The jnanendriyas are just receptors. So therefore, if the mind is receptive and the jnanendriyas are open, then the knowledge takes place. So that knowledge is opposed to karma of any kind. And so, nahi. The two together cannot just hook up and then, you know, produce jnanam. Because if jnanam is a product, we are in terrible trouble. Because then it succumbs to time. And we are talking of that I which is timeless. And then which goes against the whole bundle of shastras which say that Brahman and Atma is one. So, ekatva darshanam and or this aikyam. Aikyam means this oneness. This oneness is not something that needs to be established by karma. It is already there. And if it is already there, it has to be discovered, it has to be assimilated, it has to be known, it has to be understood. It has to be understood as myself alone, as my own nature. It has to be owned up. And so this knowledge alone can do that. Karma cannot. So, even in dreams, na sampadaitum swapnepi, you know, na sampadaitum shakyam, not possible, he says. And then he gives two other reasons. Vidyayaha,
vidyayaha,
kala vishesha,
kala vishesha,
bhavat,
bhavat.
Not bhavat, abhavat,
aniyata,
nimittatvat, kala sankocha, anupapattihi. So this we'll see after the break.
we'll take 15 minutes just to, you know, stretch and then come back.
Om Purnamidam Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.
I'll take any questions if there are in the break. Online also, if there are any questions, you can tell.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Is Shankara addressing this to people who thought that just by devotion, meditation, they can achieve knowledge?
Yeah.
Is he trying to tell them that that's not the case?
Yes. Because, you know, even in ancient India, they had fear of missing out, and they were, you know, here, of course, people go to now, the pursuits are much more varied and sophisticated. There, the pursuits were basically two, Vaidika and Laukika. Vaidika means religious pursuits, Laukika means everyday pursuits. But really speaking, this being a religious culture, there was nothing that was non-religious. The whole thing was a religious pursuit. The whole thing was spiritual. Because marriage was for the sake of clarity and self-growth, children were for the sake of self-growth, everything was for the sake of being a better person, so that one can qualify for this ultimate pursuit. So all pursuits were for the sake of this pursuit alone. And that was what a Vaidika life was. But then people forgot that, because it's easy to, you know, get caught up in whatever one is doing. And when Adi Shankara came, that is why Adi Shankara is seen as a quote-unquote minor avatara, because people had become karmathas. Karmatha means they were just given to karma. They thought moksha means going to heaven. So somewhere they go and sit down, and then they thought that they are not going to come back. But even if they come back, let's see later, we don't have to worry. Right now we just have to do everything that will take us to heaven. That's why he did what is called Shankara Vijaya, means the travel of Adi Shankara from Kashmir to Kanyakumari. All the way he traveled by foot, okay? Yeah. So by foot, many times, three times he traveled all over India to only prove the point that this karma and jnanam don't, you know, and by just doing only karma, you are not gaining this knowledge, because it's just putting you into the spell of samsara. Because even if you, let's say, if it was technically possible to do only good karma, then what? When you are born as the child of an oil magnet, you know, silver spoon, golden spoon in the mouth, what is the use, you know? Without this knowledge, what is the use? So you will be born, because even good karma becomes a shackle, a golden cage, but still you are in the samsara. And so that is what was exemplified, and he did what, and now it is called Shankara Vijaya, means the victory of Adi Shankara traveling through this and doing this khandanam, because the people were very much there. So he would go and seek out the leaders in each community and do and ask for vada bhiksha. So there are two kinds of bhiksha, one is alms, and the other one is, please give me the arms of being able to debate with you. And one such place he went, and the parrot was caged outside. And this man was such a karmatha, and he was always doing yajnas. And the parrot knew all yajna mantras. The parrot would say, Shanno Mitrasyam Varunaha. The parrot was chanting outside. And he knocked on the door. Nobody opened because they were busy in the yajna. And then it was the house of this renowned scholar of the Veda who did not know that moksha is the pursuit. Even such a big scholar called Mandana Mishra. And he went to the house of Mandana Mishra. Mandana Mishra knew this much, that sannyasi has come. I have to wash his feet and invite him. So both Mr. and Mrs. Mishra invited him inside the house with great, thing, and said, how can we serve you? What can we give you? You have tread foot in our home. You have blessed our home. What can we do for you? And he says, I want vada bhiksha. And immediately that man says, but we are in the middle of yajna. And his wife pinches him and says, this is not the way to do this. Yeah, her name was Ubhaya Bharati, great lady. She just nudges, pinches him and shoves him and says, this is not the correct thing to do. You know, they have a moment which is more important. What a sannyasi asks or what this yajna is all about. So finally he says, okay, he gives his assistants to finish the yajna and takes him to a different room. And Ubhaya Bharati herself, a scholar of the Vedas, becomes the adjudicator between the two. Imagine what kind of a standing she must have had in society for people to select her as the adjudicator, as the mediator of who is the winner of this debate. And she says, I don't want anybody to say, my husband is there, so there is a conflict of interest. So I'm going to pray to Goddess Saraswati. And she stands there in the middle of the two contenders, Adi Shankara and her own husband, and prays. And two garlands, it is said, drops from the sky. Or we can perhaps say she went to the altar and gets the two garlands. Garlands the husband and garlands Adi Shankara. And says, whosoever garland dries up from the heat of the stress of the, you know, feeling. Because dries up means what? It's stressful to be in this situation and the loser will be more stressed out. And the garland of the loser will dry out more quickly. And then that is the person who has lost the debate. And of course, Mandana Mishra loses the debate. These are the very topics that are discussed. And then, you know, as is the custom, the one who loses the debate becomes the disciple of the winner. So Mandana Mishra falls down at the feet of Adi Shankara and says, I am your disciple, rechristened as Sureshwaracharya. You know, becomes one of the disciples that we see sitting at the feet of Adi Shankara. So this, I mean, if Mandana Mishra took so long and he needed a debate to be convinced, so what to talk of the regular people? I mean, he is such a scholar. Still, he had some kind of a disbelief. He thought karma was the only thing. Even now people think that. People say, why waste your time in this, you know? But parents get dejected whenever the children pursue this knowledge, you know? Now new 3-year course is starting in India. It will produce a batch of dejected parents. It's what it is. Like, oh, what are you going to do with your education? What are you going to do with this? Somehow the feeling is you're wasting your life. Yeah. Because you're not being productive. Productive means karmatha. Understand. Just take a 5-minute break.